I'm Shane, this is Relative Time, and get ready for the Quirky Collection. This is actually part two of my 2024 State of the Collection. And if you missed part one, there'll be a link down below, and that was more of my core collection, the more normal everyday stuff I wear. Whereas today, I'm gonna go over about a dozen of my more fun, my more unusual, and straight up weird watches I have. And these are ones I don't necessarily wear that often, but because they're so unique, I don't wanna get rid of them either. So let's get to it. And I should note that these aren't in any particular order, but we are gonna start off with one of my favorites, which is my Brumetric chronograph. I've talked about this one in a few other videos, and that this is a watch I really shouldn't like, as it's one that seems to break all the regular design rules. It's got a square case, an asymmetrical dial design, an almost sterile dial with just the subtlest of branding, and really funky lug width, to say the least. And I actually bought it with the idea that I was going to review it and then probably sell it after. But in the end, it won me over. And not just me, my wife really likes it, and I got a couple of friends who aren't even into watches who are thinking about buying one. It's kind of like a pug puppy, where it's so odd and awkward, you just can't help but smile. However, for me, what makes this one so great isn't that it's just a fun and quirky piece, but that it's also very functional, very comfortable, and a watch with terrific presence, making it just a great watch overall. For number two, we got the original King of Loom, the Phoebus Great Wall. And if you're a fan of the channel, you knew this one was gonna be here somewhere. Now, this is the first gen Great Wall, which has kind of become this cult collector's piece. It seems like a lot of Phoebus fans want them and no one can really find them, which is ironic because when it came out, it kind of failed commercially. You see, up to this point, Phoebus had really focused on the value entry-level market. And this was really their first attempt at something more. They went all out making this thing, with a ton of great color, sapphire bezel, massive amount of loom. And for a while, this was one of the best watches I've ever seen for loom, the original King of Loom, as well as an ETA movement. In fact, this may have been the last time I even saw an ETA movement in a microbrand. So Phoebus put a lot into this one, and in a lot of ways, it still had a lot of value to offer. But ultimately, it was just more than the early Phoebus fans were expecting. And you combine that with this really odd, funky dial design, even though it is original, and I think failure was inevitable. It took a long time before these ever sold out. But the thing is, when they did, that's ironically when the Phoebus fans started wanting them. And even a second, more normal Great Wall hasn't quenched that thirst. Now, I love this one not just because it's fun and funky, but because it's also highly functional, as well as well-built. It's basically like a high-end version of a Seiko Monster, something I wish Seiko would make. Now, believe it or not, the Great Wall isn't my strangest diver. I actually have two more coming that might have it beat. The first of which is the Zelis Abyss 3, which I gotta say has a rather normal design, at least for a Zelis. Or Zelos, however you want to say it. But the thing is, this thing's ridiculous with a capital R. It is so overbuilt that it's insane. Now, this is Zelis' attempt at a deep diver. So it has 3,000 meters of water resistance. And let me repeat that, 3,000. No one needs that. Now, it is a Zelis, so it's well-designed, easy to read, and fantastic loom. But it's so over-engineered, it's crazy. I mean, just look how thick and chunky this thing is. And the fact that it's bronze is just icing on the cake. This is like the Ford Raptor of the watch world, a truck no normal person ever really needs. It's a vehicle that's so overbuilt for off-roading, you definitely don't need to take it on your daily commute to the office. And people do, especially around here in Dallas. But that doesn't mean it's not cool. And that's exactly what's going on here. This thing is funky, it's weird, it's overbuilt, but it is cool, which is why I still have it. It's so crazy and I can't see ever buying anything remotely like it. So figured I might as well hold on to it. Although as crazy as the Abyss is, the design of the next watch is the strangest diver I've ever seen. This is the prototype for the Ikigai Kaizen, a watch that's so odd it never got made. Now, some of you may be familiar with the brand's other watch, the Maru, a Tron-esque style diver, which had a successful Kickstarter last year. But before the Maru, there was the Kaizen, a compressor-style diver with a pretty unusual design. Honestly, I'm not even sure what to call this one. When I reviewed it, I liked it because it was so well built and because it was so unusual. You see, the thing is with us reviewers, we see so many normal watches that when something as odd as this comes around, we find it refreshing. That, and I just love the sharp red dial here, as well as the interesting loom. Although in terms of crazy loom, the Maru blows us out of the way. But it is more of a normal diver, where this thing is just completely different. For number 5, we're going to go from a rare oddity to a brand that is mostly hated in the watch community. No, it's not an MVMT, but we are talking about a Shinola. However, it's not just any Shinola, but a Mickey Shinola. Now, despite what some say, after actually owning a few, I can tell you that Shinolas are well built. They're as good as most Seikos and Citizens in the $300 to $500 price range. The trick is that Shinolas are usually more, so they are overpriced, and buying them used is best. And I think a lot of the hate comes from watch enthusiasts who don't get that their watches aren't really made for us. They're made for regular people who don't want to deal with an automatic, yet still want a good watch that doesn't feel like it's made of cheap plastic, which these days is harder and harder to find. That's Shinola's niche. Anyway, a few years ago, Shinola and Disney actually had a very short-lived partnership. I think maybe like a year. And this is one of the watches that came out of it. And after that partnership died, a lot of them went on clearance, which is when I got this one. To me, this is one of the best Mickeys out there, as it's better made than most of the cheaper Citizen watches. And I love that the design is a callback to those classic old watches, yet done maybe a little bit more sophisticated, more adult, as it's just a silhouette instead of a full cartoon, which I think is more me, and in some ways makes this a bit of a hidden Mickey. Now, next, I want to go over a couple of my modded watches that I keep around. And up first out of those is probably my most famous, and that's my Vostok Amphibia, which has been around since the early days of the channel. And as far as mods go, this one's pretty light. If you know Vostok's, it's basically an orange scuba dude in the smaller 420 case, with an aftermarket orange bezel thrown on top of it, giving it just a little bit of a Planet Ocean vibe. In fact, someone even asked me that once. Not quite. And for those of you who've noticed this weird shirt I'm wearing from time to time, it's one I have made up. It's supposed to be the Vostok scuba dude mixed with the character of the dude from The Big Lebowski. I thought it was funny, but I got a weird sense of humor. Next is a Catassin homage of a Longines Conquest. This is a watch that I liked when I first got it, enough so that I eventually got a real Conquest. But at the time, I also really didn't like the hands that came on it. So in one of my first modding attempts, I decided to swap the hands to something else, to these kind of hollowed out Sin-style aviation hands, creating what I think is actually a pretty cool watch. Enough so that one of the Catassin stores actually stole this image and put it on their Instagram like it was a watch that was coming. True story, a viewer caught it and they alerted me to it. And eventually they took it down. And at this point, I do have a few modified Casios thanks to SKX Mod. But out of those, I think my favorite is the Bronze Casio Royale, because it's a Bronze Casio Royale. I mean, come on. For number 7, we have a pretty rare Vario Eclipse, and I apologize ahead of time that this watch is pretty hard to show on camera. So I'll try to make this quick. If you don't remember the Eclipse, it was one of Vario's first watches. In this particular colorway, which I think is a Tanzanite blue, never went into production. From what I know, Ivan created two of them as tests, and then one Christmas a few years ago, he put this one up in a silent auction to benefit a hospice organization in Singapore. And as someone who's had a few close family members in hospice, it's kind of close to my heart. And I think hospice organizations, as well as the people who work there, are vastly underappreciated. It's one of those things you don't even know about until you need it. So I put a bid in, and I was actually surprised I won. Like I said, this one is really hard to capture with those flat, polished Affine hands. They just seem to disappear. But in person, this dial color is amazing. And the watch is just classically beautiful. And speaking of rare prototypes, some of you may remember the Comet chronograph. which is still one of the best dials I've seen. Unfortunately, this is another Kickstarter that didn't quite make it, but at the same time, it's also a watch filled with some good life lessons. The watch itself is a gorgeous Art Deco style chronograph, and a lot of reviewers loved it for that. But like Icarus, this Kickstarter tried to fly way too close to the sun. You see, rather than just focus on a handful of really good colorways, the brand's creator decided to go the full Monty and throw 10 really nice ones in as potential options. The problem with that is that each dial has its own MOQ coming from the factory, or minimum order quantity, meaning the more colorways, the more he had to raise for the Kickstarter. And while it raised quite a bit, it didn't quite make it. Now, right after it failed, I spoke to the brand's owner, and he was actually devastated both emotionally and financially, as he put quite a lot of money trying to get this thing off the ground. But the thing is, a year later, I put a photo of this one up on Instagram, and I got an email from him. Turns out someone really high up in the design department of a really well-known company happened to see the Kickstarter. They really liked what he was doing and reached out to him on the off chance he was looking for a job. And in the end, he wound up getting his dream job out of all of it. So there was a happy ending. And one of the reasons I keep this one around is that it reminds me that you can't always get what you want. But if you try sometimes, well, you might find you get what you need. Now, for number 9, we're going to go back to something a bit funky, with the Mr. Jones Number Cruncher. Late last year, I bought one to review, and hopefully that'll be coming soon. And I'm not sure if I'm going to keep this one around long term, but because it is a really odd, fun, and funky watch, I thought I'd throw it in here. If you've never seen any of the Mr. Jones watches out there, go check them out. They're all just a little bit off, but they're all kind of fun. And one of the things that's cool about this one is that it is an automatic jumping hour movement, where the number up here at the top that he's about to eat is the hour, down there on the stomach you have the minute, and then if you look closely, there's a small seconds behind that with just random debris churning. It's strange, there's no question about that, but it's also cool to see what creative people can do with just a standard movement. And speaking of standard, let's talk about a watch that isn't. See, that's what I call a smooth segue. Now, this is the Seiga Blue Planet Gilded version, a watch that I reviewed a while ago, which I still have because it's crazy. You see, the original Blue Planet was already a bit nutty, where it had a customized movement integrated into this really funky, hard-to-read, rotating world interface. It's way too hard to explain here. But the thing is, they took that nutty watch and just doubled down on the crazy when they made this one. As not only is the 3D textured earth now covered in 24 karat gold, but the case and the bracelet are also full ceramic. Why? Just because they could. And in some ways, that's also how number 11 came into existence. Although this watch is actually far more important than many people realize or give it credit. It's the Solus Starlight, and I think it's responsible for all the new micro rotor watches that have started popping up, particularly from Yema and Baltic. The Starlight crawled so that they could walk. The story behind this one is that the brand's owner Daniel was a bit obsessed with micro rotor movements. Getting one was one of his grails, but until recently, everything out there was extremely expensive and specialized. What changed is that Hangzhou developed a reasonably priced movement in China. Yet, even after they did, it sat around for a few years because no one really seemed to know what to do with it. Except for Daniel, who was a watch enthusiast, decided that this needed to be a thing, and that if no one else was going to use it to create a watch, he was. So he developed the Starlight and painstakingly got it over its Kickstarter goal, proving that the market had a place for a reasonably priced micro rotor, something Baltic must have noticed as they came out with their watch a year later. Now, if there's one watch that absolutely had to be on this list, it's this one. And in some ways, I've saved the best for last, because this is the Akora Wayfarer, which is another prototype from an almost brand. It's a watch with a very cool, interesting take on an alpinist, and bonus points for a red dial. Although, I actually kind of got the red dial by default. So the story with this one is that about halfway through its Kickstarter, I got sent a gray prototype to review. Yet, the thing is, I had actually already decided to back that Kickstarter before the prototype even showed up. If I remember right, this is right after the Alpinist Sarb 017 got discontinued, And since I never got one, I saw this as a really cool, interesting alternative. And when I got the prototype, I just instantly bonded with it. But the thing is, a few days after I got that prototype, the brand owner actually canceled the Kickstarter for whatever reason. And at this point, I was pretty disappointed because I was already in love with it. I'm guessing that maybe he reran the finance numbers, and even though it was close to hitting its goal, it wasn't going to quite work out. So it was dead, and shortly after I emailed him asking what he wanted me to do with the prototype. And at the end, I made sure to say that if he was ever interested in selling it, I'd buy it. Of which he quickly replied that another reviewer had already beat me to it. And after he gave me the address to send it to, I instantly recognized it. It was another reviewer I occasionally talked to. He used to write for the Time Bomb. So I sent him an email calling him an SOB for beating me to it and just letting him know his watch was on the way. But that he shouldn't worry if it now had an Invicta logo on it. And I actually came pretty close to send him a Pro Diver first, just as a joke, but nah, I sent him the watch. And maybe a month or so later, I got another email from the brand owner saying that he had one more prototype left. But the thing is, it was a red dial. And at this point, I wasn't quite obsessed with red dials as I am now. So I was a little hesitant, but ultimately I jumped on it, and I'm glad I did. It's strange, it's unusual, but it's a killer looking watch. And if you haven't noticed, a lot of these quirkier watches have stories attached to them from my time as a reviewer, which is one of the reasons I still have them. Anyway, that's all I got for you. Thanks for checking out my quirky watches, as well as reminiscing with me. And as usual, let me know what you think down below about the watches, about what your quirky watches are, or just anything. And as always, if you enjoyed the video, like, comment, subscribe, do something down below, helps the channel. I'm Shane, this is Relative Time, and I'll see you next time.